1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, end of test. This Houston, contact with the test 1. Roger, gear lock clear here. Also.
The future astronaut of the European Space Agency. Today at the Galactic Chloé Show, you will learn everything you need to know about the next ESA selection. Men and women, and even people with disabilities, inclusiveness is the motto of this selection.
I want to be part of something big, a meaningful project on a global scale. I applied to become an astronaut. Why not you?
And to discuss this selection, who else than the one and only Swiss astronaut who went to space 4 times on board the space shuttle, ladies and gentlemen, Claude Nicollier. Hi, Claude.
Hi.
Welcome on the moon.
Thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here with you, Chloé, and I feel very privileged to be invited to the Galactic Chloé Show.
The privilege is mine. I really like your suit. It's cooler than mine.
Well, yours is more like the first astronaut. I remember the Mercury astronaut. They also had shiny suit like this. This is a more standard blue astronaut suit.
So for the Swiss people, you need no introduction, but for international audience, can you introduce yourself a bit more?
Well, I'm Claude Nicollier. I was an ESA astronaut for many years. In fact, I was selected in the first group in 1978. Originally, I was an astrophysicist and a pilot in the Air Force in Switzerland. Became an astronaut in the first group together with Ulf Merbold and Vubo Ockels, 1978, long time ago, 43 years ago. Then I was assigned to the Johnson Space Center, Houston, to train on the space shuttle. Spent 12 years in Houston before my first flight, which was in 1992. But after this first flight, it was bang, 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 3 more flights in the 90s. And I had the great privilege to be able to go and visit the Hubble Space Telescope on 2 occasions. This was wonderful. I left ESA in 2007, and now I'm teaching at Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne, EPFL, with pleasure. I teach space technology, and all that I learned during these 25 years in Houston, I'm teaching to students now. Great pleasure.
And you are the only astronaut from Switzerland. I've heard you're looking for a successor.
Yes, I want a successor.
Are you a Jedi?
I am. Come, little one.
I would say that Switzerland and Europe and planet Earth need another astronaut from Switzerland. I'm retired since many years now. We want to have another one.
And so the selection closes on the 28th of May, so only in a few days. What are the requirements to become an ESA astronaut?
Well, there are some basic requirements. Studies in sciences or in engineering or in medicine, and 3 years experience of a job after the degree, or typically a master's degree. Then I would say good health and mental stability, to say it short.
And how many astronauts are they looking for?
I guess of the order of 4 to 6 astronauts, career astronauts. In addition, they plan to have so-called reserve astronauts in order to spread and have a larger group of potential flyers in space compared to the small group that they have now that will be added with 4 to 6. They want to have a larger group. And from this group that will fulfill all the requirements, ESA will pick one or the other in the following years in order to, again, give a possibility to a wider group of people to fly in space.
And should we be selected, what is the process? What does it look like?
Well, there are 6 steps total that will be divided between this year, 2021, and 2022. And the first step is really application. So basically, and this is what has to be done before the 28th of May. For the ones who are successful in this application, there will be another period, which is cognitive test and personality test and technical test. That's going to be sometime in the summer of this year. There will be then a third stage this year, which will be evaluation of the ability of the candidates to be performance and be really efficient in their performance, either as a one person at a time or in groups. This will be evaluated at the end of this year. This is a psycho test, mainly as a group. And the next year there will be medical selection, then there will be interviews, general interviews. At the very end there will be the interview by the director general. So after these six steps ending at the end of 2022, the director general will pick the four up to six and the 20 reserve astronauts.
Well, this is the most important question, but for you, what is the right stuff to become an astronaut?
Well, you have to be motivated, of course, and passion. Not too much passion, but quite a lot of passion. Somebody who is too much passionate is going to be just one-sided. But you have to have quite a lot of passion and the will to serve the system on one hand. You have to be able to communicate, be able to do well with people from other nations and other cultures. But you must have a pretty solid technical and scientific background and medical background also in order to be able to go smoothly through the training. The training is really like drinking out of a fire hose. It's a lot of information in a relatively short time. So you need to be able to really grasp all of that, integrate it in your personality, and then be efficient during the space missions, serving not so much yourself, but serving the community, serving the needs of the agency, and serving humanity, finally. It's a service to humanity.
Easy job. Easy job. And so we've seen that ESA is really putting at the forefront diversity and inclusiveness. Do you think we are lacking diversity in the space field?
We are. I would say in Europe we have seven active astronauts right now. We have only one woman, Samantha Cristoforetti from Italy. They're all very good. There's no doubt about that. But ESA needs more. And ESA would like to increase the diversity, have more women. There will be also a larger diversity in the countries represented. We have, of course, the major countries, Germany and France and Italy, which are well represented. Very few small countries. The idea is in the career, but also the reserve astronaut, to have astronauts from various nations. The idea is to try to have at some point one astronaut at least in each of the 22 nations that are members of the European Space Agency.
That you can see right here. Right here.
Yes. At the time I was there, there were 17 member states, so I have 17 here. When I started at the very beginning, there were 11. When I flew, 17, now 22. And there will be more.
Hopefully. And so what would be the solution for you to include more women and more citizenships?
Well, I think it's to motivate citizens, male and female, in each of these nations to apply. I mean, the main thing is to apply and not hesitate to apply. I think this is the main ingredient to get more diversity. And of course, at some point, when the final selection will be made, if there is a man and a woman with equal qualifications, probably ESA will pick the woman. You know?
Yeah, because there is something called the imposter syndrome that we've all experienced once in our life. It's, for instance, thinking that we're not good enough or that there is anyway someone better than us, so no care of applying.
Well,
what would you say to those people?
Each of the potential candidates should put this on the side. I mean, in each person there is a treasure. There are qualifications that expect to be blooming if the right selection is made. And again, sometimes these capabilities, they are kind of hidden, but apply, make this step, believe in yourself, and then you will be able to make this treasure in yourself bloom. And this is a wonderful job. It's an incredible job, the best job you can imagine.
This is very inspiring. And actually, we have the privilege to have a testimony from a potential applicant, Eleonora Poli. She is a PhD student at Cambridge, Swiss citizen and LGBT. Let's hear more about her.
Hi, Chloe. My name is Eleonora Poli. I am a Swiss PhD student at the University of Cambridge in the UK. I'm studying material science, and on the side, I'm a global shaper, an athlete, a pianist, and I'm applying to become an astronaut.
Why would you like to become an astronaut?
For many reasons. I think being an astronaut is probably one of the most fantastic jobs you can ever have. You combine pushing your limits, learning every day, and mainly contributing to science and to humanity's progress. It's one of the most beautiful things you can do.
Do you think diversity plays a major role in the space field today?
I think that diversity is important in any part of society. And now that we're trying to go to the moon and maybe to Mars and actually probably have settlements and a new civilization on Mars or the moon, we need this diversity to be able to recreate the society that we have and actually better it.
A word to the other candidates who are thinking of applying.
The same motto as ESA, don't self-select. If somebody tells you you can't do it, just try. You have nothing to lose. And the preparation is actually the best way to put your feet inside somebody else's shoes to think, look, I'm doing the first step to become an astronaut, which is to dare. Even when you think you don't have a chance, take it, because you never know.
ESA is looking for a diverse team in terms of gender, ages, but not only. They're not giving the opportunity to people with disabilities to apply. It's called the Para-Astronaut Feasibility Project. Claude, this is a brand new project that no other agencies have attempted yet.
That's correct. But I think ESA is starting, and I'm sure that it will be taken up by other agencies later. This is so normal to do this at this time, diversity. I think it's a great idea that ESA is doing that. And candidates who have some disabilities, mainly in the lower part of the body, or who are of short size, less than 130 centimeters, will have the possibility to apply. They will be initially in the reserve corps of astronauts, but at some point they'll be able to fly in space. I think this is wonderful. It's a great idea.
And I actually have some great news. ESA permitted me to have a direct link with Earth to interview the head of this para-astronaut feasibility study, Stéphane Gist, live from the moon.
Yes, I'm in the management team of the European Astronaut Center, and I'm assisting the ESA head of the International Space Station Program to manage all our engineering and operational activities related to the space station. And also, more generally speaking, I'm also involved in the management of the activities of the training center.
What will the para-astronauts do? Will they get to fly?
Exactly what the other professional astronauts are required to do. And this is very important. But in addition, they will also be fully involved in this feasibility study I was talking about earlier, as we will need their experience and expertise all along the project. Of course, we cannot promise anything, but we want to really to try hard. To fly an astronaut with disabilities is really our objective. And the feasibility study will give us very good hints about what are the possibilities to achieve this objective.
Do you have advice for all potential astronauts and para-astronauts?
For both, I would say, just follow your dreams.
One anecdote about working with Claude Nicollier?
One comment I would like to do. At the time I was training Claude, it was already some years ago, Claude was already extremely experienced. And therefore, I was showing up in front of him, trying to teach him some basics of rendezvous and docking, but for sure I had nothing to teach him because he already knew everything before I spoke up. So somehow it was quite interesting, but very stressing for me to be confronted, let's say, to Claude.
Claude, do you think that one day we will be able to send people with more disabilities?
I think so. I think this is the beginning of something that will open up. You know, it's like, you know, now we have a lot of private companies involved, and more we'll have private companies. Now we open the door to candidates with disabilities. This will open up, I'm sure.
And of course, you know, this is a subject that touches me more now that I lost part of my sight.
Yeah.
And I really hope that maybe one day I can even fly with this problem.
I have no doubt that you're going to make it. Really. And I think even candidates that are paraplegic at some point may be able, with exoskeleton, to be able to go into space and be productive in space. They may not be able to go spacewalking, but sometimes they will be able to perform. This will open up. You have all your chance, Chloe.
Thank you, Claude. This is so inspiring. And this is why this project is so exciting, to see that we're moving on and trying to have more people included in space exploration.
Absolutely, yes, yes. And this is a very positive step. And of course, the destinations will be extremely interesting in the future. Of course, there will be low Earth orbit always, but there will be the trips to the moon, scientific work on the moon, including on the far side of the moon. And then there will be Mars and maybe other celestial bodies in the solar system. This is very exciting.
So we've talked a lot about the selection, but not so much about you. I actually have a few questions for you. I don't always have the pleasure to have an astronaut on stage. What is the best memory you have from your career in space?
Well, of course, there are a lot of great moments in any space mission. But for me, as a former astrophysicist who became an astronaut, going to Hubble was an incredible privilege. And when I spacewalked in December 1999 on my last mission, together with Mike Fole, we exchanged the main computer of Hubble and one of the fine guidance sensors, and when for the first time I could, with my gloved hand, touch the handrail at the bottom of Hubble, this is a very special moment. I think this is the best moment I ever had in my astronaut life so far.
And if you could go back tomorrow, would you say yes?
Of course I would. And I would go to the moon.
To the moon?
Yes.
Why the moon?
Well, because low Earth orbit is amazing, and this great privilege to be in low Earth orbit because you see the Earth, you see a lot of detail of the Earth, but going to another celestial body, this is very inspiring. And I've been extremely inspired by the Apollo program. I was in my mid-20s. I had finished my studies in astrophysics, and I was a military pilot. And when I saw these people going on the moon, this was so exciting. And the fact that we go back to the moon, including the partners of the US, Canada, Japan, and Europe, this is wonderful.
And what is more wonderful is that we will learn a bit more about you with your logbook, Live from the Moon. Discovery or Atlantis?
Discovery.
Corona or Desperados?
Corona!
NASA or ESA?
Both.
Hubble or James Webb?
Of course, I have Hubble in my heart, so I'm biased toward Hubble. But James Webb is going to be amazing.
This was really a true pleasure for me to welcome you at the Galactic Chloé Show, Claude. Do you have a final message for all potential applicants watching us?
Well, there's a clear message, and it's simple. It's apply, apply, apply. I mean, you are going to make it, maybe, and maybe you will not make it, because obviously it's very competitive. Others do apply, not only you. But if you go through the whole selection process or part of the selection process and it doesn't work, you will have learned so much. It will have been a wonderful period of contact with a lot of people who have the same passion, same interest as you. Do apply, and hopefully you will make it. If you don't make it, you will always remember in your life this wonderful time that you spent in the selection.
Claude Nicollier, one and only Swiss astronaut looking for a successor, and it might be you. The selection closes in a few days on the 28th of May. Seize the opportunity and come visit us at the Lunar Campus at the Galactic Chloé Show.